Jigs and Bigs is proud to announce we're being supported by Old Glory Outdoors. They're a veteran-owned company that carries fishing and hunting gear. Plus, they're highly active in supporting veteran organizations and charities. Old Glory is an authorized dealer of Favorite Rods, FX Rods, Guggen Baits, X-Zone Lures, Sixth Sense, and many more. There's a brick-and-mortar store located in East Brookfield, Massachusetts, but you can also order online at oldgloryoutdoors.com. They ship anywhere in the lower 48 states or order online and pick up at the store. When you order, use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS and you'll save 10% off your complete order. Plus, you'll help support the show. Make sure to check out the apparel line called OGO Gear while you're there. Old Glory Outdoors believes in the slogan "Start 'em Young" to keep kids away from screens and enjoying nature. They've got a full array of live bait too. Check out oldgloryoutdoors.com and use the promo code JIGSANDBIGS. Save some money and gear up now. All right, guys, how you doing? Bobby Roast Beef here for another episode of Jigs and Bigs. We have one significant episode tonight, guys. So this is the first episode that is airing in the month of July. I hope everybody had a wonderful 4th of July. I did. I was away on vacation with my family and some other families we are friends with. We decided we would escape to the lovely state of Vermont and stay in a little rental house out there for a little while, and I did do a little bit of fishing out there. Had no luck getting any bass at all. I did catch some rock bass. I caught three or four rock bass, and I also caught some yellow perch, which was nice. Went to a bunch of different bodies of water, but nothing really crazy happening out there. Had a great time, though. We cooked a bunch of really great food. We had some laughs, and it was just great. All the kids were playing in the pool, and it was really, really, really nice. A different kind of 4th of July, I will say. No big fireworks, displays or anything like huge like that going on, but definitely had a good time celebrating our independence. So it was pretty, pretty cool. I like that. As far as what's been going on lately, well, like I said, we're in the month of July, which means that the Chronic Trips Elevated Virtual Fishing Tournament has come to a close. It means that we actually have some winners here, and we've got some results. So actually, I'm going to go ahead and go through the breakdown there for who won and how it was all working for the results for the June tournament right now. And then I'll fill you in on what's coming down in the show. Our Chronic Trips Elevated Fishing Tournament. Well, the virtual fishing tournament results look like this. We had three basic prize-winning locations for the finals right here. There was a prize for longest stringer, so longest overall stringer. We had longest overall fish, so of any species, the longest fish caught. That would also qualify for a prize. And then catching a bigger brown trout than can athlete Mark. That, if you caught a larger brown trout than Mark, you would also be taking away some winnings as well. So the results, this is how it worked. Top prize for longest stringer, no big surprise there. It went to Sean the Fisherman. Yeah, our very own Sean the Fisherman. And you'll get some feedback on what he thought of this whole tournament in our later segment. He had a total stringer length of 279 3/4 inches. That is significant. Nice job. The longest overall fish, however, that award goes to Aaron. Aaron got a 43-inch spiny dogfish, and that, if I'm not mistaken, that catch right there was the one that kind of had myself and Sean kind of scratching our heads like, does this mean this is over? Like, this is a big, this is going to be tough to beat. You know, I mean, ultimately, that's the thing. This is going to be tough to beat for, you know, especially for the freshwater guys. But and as far as the larger brown trout than can athlete Mark, nobody successfully caught a larger brown trout than Mark. So there is no winner for that category. So I believe that the prize then goes to the other two, gets split up there, I believe. Anyway, it was a really, really good time. I had a blast. It definitely had me thinking – differently about the way that I fish and the decisions that I make when I'm looking to choose a spot to fish. So it definitely was great for that. Being multi-species was really kind of interesting too, because it made you think a little bit more outside the box. Yes, primarily everything I caught were largemouth and smallmouth. I did do a couple of bonehead maneuvers on my end, but I had a blast. I really did. And part one of this episode is our sit down, our powwow with Seth over at Chronic Trips. Seth joins us on a call at the conclusion of the tournament. Sean the Fisherman and I had a little Zoom meeting with Sean. We got some more information. And talk a little bit about what's coming up for August. Because remember, these tournaments will be running on alternate months. So every other month, you can join a tournament and have yourself a great time, catch some fish and win some prizes, and just ultimately have some fun. Take what you like doing and add that competitive element to it. You'd be amazed at just how much fun can be had there. So that's part one of what we have coming up. Part two is this. I had, I would say a listener, but he actually hit me up on Fishbrain first. Adam Laxton had sent me a message. We had been talking back and forth a bit on Fishbrain. For those that don't know, Fishbrain is an app. It's like kind of like a social media app for anglers. You can log catches. You can interact and you can meet other anglers from your area. You can share tips. You can review stuff. I mean, it's really, really cool. Adam had hit me up a while back, noticing that I had fished a lot of the waters in his area. He had asked some questions and we kind of just started talking back and forth. And through that, I had mentioned the podcast. He started listening to the podcast and, you know, eventually it was just, okay, I'd love to have you on the show, man. You should come on. So Adam has been fishing for a short period of time, but he's really, really passionate about it, jumped right into it. So we have a quick interview with him coming up after we hear from Seth and Sean the Fisherman for our little post fishing tournament wrap up. Speaking of tournaments, we are actively working on some stuff. I'll tell you, the big major holdout right now is the COVID lockdown, and just basically, we want to do this, but we want to make sure that people feel comfortable coming out for a meetup, you know, and all that stuff, because we want to obviously you know, meet listeners, and also we're going to have some merch there on site that people can check out. So we want to make sure that people are comfortable coming out to this kind of event. Also, we need to find a place to host this. So we need to make sure that they're able to do so as well. So it is something that we're definitely working on. We're getting closer and closer and closer, but it's just a matter of time to kind of put some things out there. Now, before we get to any of these other interviews, I have a little bit of as far as fishing for me. Now, I mentioned I had been in Vermont for the last week, and I had fished a couple of places. One of my favorite fishing spots is available now. I can start fishing at again, which is great. I went over there. I have a couple things I've been working on. I have a Shimano Corrado that I have been fishing with for a little over a week now, and I will have a full review of that reel coming shortly. I just want to give it a little bit more time to get out and catch some more fish with it and kind of use it in some other applications. Right now, I've been using it primarily for frogs, buzz baits, and some other top water. I kind of want to experiment a little bit and kind of have a little bit of fun with it and see where all this can go. So today, which is Monday the 6th, I had gone out with Tim Jacks. He took me out on his boat. Again, thank you, Tim. It's always a good time fishing with Tim. And we went out and we fished a few spots that he was looking to kind of pre-fish a little bit. And we went out and I was having a rough day. It was just, we were out in the sun. I was exhausted. It was kind of like seeing stuff. I felt like, you know, just, it wasn't happening. He had caught three or four while we were out. Nothing huge. I think he caught maybe a couple of twos or a two and a half in there. Not too bad. And then I broke my PB. I know just recently I put out a post about there being, you know, officially it's an 18.5 inch largemouth. That's my PB. I broke it today. I caught a 19. She weighed in at, 3.86 pounds and was caught on a drop shot. A drop shot that had on that hook It had an unreleased Hookset Hoodlums Wild Worm. If you don't know what that is, it's because it's unavailable just yet, but it's coming soon. My good friends over at Hookset Hoodlums, Wild Bill and Andrew Tomer, they hooked me up with a little bag of some of their Wild Worms. And the Wild Worms, they're a 4-inch style stick bait, and this one color has like this gold flake. Really, really, really like bright, brilliant gold flake. So I had rigged this on a round bed worm hook and used it as a drop shot, and I had cast into basically try to just fish over the top of some grass on some patches, and I dropped this bait in there, and you know, the bait had sunk, hit the bottom, and I kind of clicked the bail back over, and the sun is just right overhead. I've just been beaten down on me, and I'm like, okay, I gotta get some water. I just gotta stretch a little bit. My goodness. And then I start working the bait, and I decide I'm just going to reel it in. And all of a sudden, it's just unbelievably heavy. And I'm like, I've got a good fish on. This is pretty amazing. And this fish comes in, and it probably would have broke 4 pounds, but there was a big old chunk taken out of its tail. And I'm assuming that's from a northern pike, because you can find those in that body of water pretty regularly. And so there was a nice chunk. So it probably would have broke 4 pounds. That is the new PB. I didn't take measurements to get a replica made yet. I was like, this isn't, it's not going to be right. You know, it's just not going to be right. I got to go even bigger. So I'm looking to beat 19, and then we'll do the replica, 19 inches. So that's the goal. I got to beat that. That's what we're going to do. Anyway, that was my PB story for today, or my epic fishing story. And it was such a good feeling. Absolutely fantastic. I can't thank Tim enough for taking me out with him. It's always a good time. If you don't know who Tim is, go back and listen to episode 3 or 4 with Tim Jacks. He is a great guy. He is the president of the Northeast Bass Anglers Club, and they do some great stuff, some really, really good charity tournaments, as well as a regular ongoing schedule of tournaments. This year's been kind of crazy for everybody with tournaments, but, obviously because of the limitations that are out there, but they have some really good stuff going on. In fact, we were even talking about ways to tie in Jigs and Bigs with some upcoming stuff with any bass anglers. So that could be pretty awesome. Anyway, guys, let's get to it. We're going to go ahead and take a short break right here. But when we get back, we've got Sean the Fisherman and Seth Frappier from Chronic Trips. We will then go into our interview with Adam Laxton. Guys, so much more good stuff to come. Don't go too far. All right, everybody, for this next segment here, we've got Seth Frappier from Chronic Trips. Chronic Trips was the mother brain, if you will, that kind of organized all of that great stuff we had all month long in June with the Chronic Trips Elevated Virtual Fishing Tour. Whole lot of fun, but I'm also on the horn with Sean the Fisherman. Sean the Fisherman was the big winner of the Chronic Trips tournament, and to no surprise, the guy carries fishing maps in his back pocket, and he's just very much on it. So it was really, really good time overall. Gentlemen, how are you today?
Good, man.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing okay. I'm hanging in there. So we're going to go over some of the highlights that had happened and go over in detail. Now, just so that any of the listeners are aware, the next Chronic Trips tournament is going to happen in August, correct?
Yeah, August 1st, the whole month.
Perfect. 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 So this means that for you, the listener, if you want to get in, this is nationwide, you can jump in on this at any point. But if you want to get in on this next tournament happening in August, all you got to do, go to chronictrips.com and check out information there on how to join up, or go right through Fish Donkey, download the Fish Donkey app, and then just do a search for Chronic Trips. You'll see it right there. The elevated virtual fishing tournament. It's a whole lot of fun. And I got to tell you, for my first experience out, even though I was like bottom of the barrel, I feel pretty good about it, and I'm not going to complain. I'm definitely feeling all right about that. So, Sean, go ahead. I'm going to defer to you because you are much more knowledgeable about a lot of these things. Even in our conversations back and forth, I found myself going, a lot.
Well, I mean, first off, I got to thank Seth and his crew for running this. This was an absolute pleasure. The biggest takeaway that I got from the tournament after fishing, you know, primarily bass, largemouth and smallmouth bass tournaments out of a kayak for the past, I don't know how many years, five, six, whatever it's been years. This tournament with being multi-species really got me out of my comfort zone. So instead of, you know, bass and pickerel and maybe instead of largemouth and smallmouth bass, primarily being, focused on, and maybe a pickerel side pool, depending on who's running the tournament, this was everything. So initially, I know, Bobby, when you talked to me about it, yep, and said, hey, there's this tournament, you got to check this out. I mean, honestly, I looked at it and said, well, fresh and saltwater together, and it's by length, that seems kind of rough, because, you know, you and I know if no matter how many, you know, bluegill, smallmouth, even big pickerel, you put them up against a tuna or, you know, particularly I looked at that NE5 category and said, God, somebody's going to fill that with sharks, mm-hmm, and that's going to be the end of it. You know, I thought about it and I was like, well, all right, I'll jump in on it. It can't hurt. It wasn't a huge asking price, huge buy-in. It was $20. So I said, what the heck? I think the first week, Bobby, you and I were out at one of my little haunts up in the Berkshires.
Yep.
I think I caught a decent bass that I threw up there. And then I happened to catch my personal best bullhead catfish. They were, yeah, getting ready to spawn. They were in the shallows, and one of them sucked down a plastic worm. And I said, okay, that's cool. And then the next week I was out in a one-on-one tournament with a guy that I fished with for Massachusetts Kayak Bassing. We were against each other. And while I was out fishing for bass, I had a trout hit a crankbait. So I'm like, well, there's two down that are going to be my problem one. So I, you know, really put the pedal to the metal after that point. I said, well, now I'm really going to just start gunning for every fish on this list and see what I can do. And it was a blast. It was an absolute blast. So, yeah, you know, I can't ever recall going out and targeting big pickerel, but I was in an area of Mass where I know two or three bodies of water that had some really, really big pickerel, and I matched my personal best and caught three state pin size pickerel. So I was psyched. It was great. It was a blast.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. I think you and I had a conversation there, and you said, who would have known I'm the crowned prince of chain pickerel of Western Massachusetts? I'm like, damn straight. Yeah. That's pretty crazy,
I earned a title. It was great.
Absolutely. Seth, what were your – I mean, for being the first time out, I know that you guys were kind of like doing this for the first time and learning as you were growing. What's your takeaway? Like, how do you feel about the whole thing?
I think, like, it was – way more than we expected it was going to be. You know, we just thought we were going to launch this thing and have a few people and just try to have the most fun we can with it. But then it just kind of like blew up really fast. Everyone got super interested.
Yeah.
And I think the coolest part was kind of along the lines with Sean, where I was amazed that almost everybody went for a whole bunch of different kinds of fish. We didn't know what to expect. We were just listing a whole bunch of fish in the area. And people actually went for it. And there were some really gorgeous fish that people were pulling in. And I'm going to give like a really cool highlight reel of all the photos of all the fish that you guys caught, because I was just like blown away with how many you all caught, you know?
That's awesome. I could have used yesterday.
Because we've been analyzing it the last few days. And so we're just like kind of been in shock with the initial outcome and really excited for the next one to make it.
Absolutely.
Bigger, better, tweak it a little bit.
That's awesome. Are there any changes that we can expect to see that you guys have lined up, or you guys going to want to hold off and then announce that stuff later?
I don't know. Like, I think we'll hold off and we'll just let it all roll at once. That'll be fun.
No,
yeah,
that's a good idea.
You know how we like a little mystery. So.
Exactly. A little bit of mystery never hurt. But I mean, that's a really big endorsement, like what Sean said, because like he does. You don't understand, Seth. I get weekly reports about how he's doing in his tournaments regularly in full detail. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to run this by Sean and I'll see what he has to think. I'm interested in what his opinion is of this sort of like, I want to say a little like left of center type tournament with really a unique, the emphasis on fun and the emphasis on the outdoors.
Yeah.
But
absolutely,
a really sort of unique kind of way to get people out there and enjoy. And honestly, I got to say, your timing could not have been even any more perfect, because it launched June 1st. And right now we're seeing more people out at the water. And you know, with that, there comes some growing pains. But you're seeing more people out on the water now more than ever. And I think the hardest thing is to get people interested in out there fishing. And by adding this element of a game, essentially, you really, really kind of stoke that competitive fire. you know, for the best. So I wouldn't be surprised if we break, you know, 50 or 60 entries in the next one and then double that in October.
Fantastic. And I just got to say thank you, Sean, for all the input and the kind words, because hearing the feedback from everybody has been really great in helping us make it better in the future. And our whole goal was to connect people to nature, have some fun, and have some friendly competition and stoke the fire of that a little bit, you know. Yeah. and plant a whole bunch of trees in the Amazon. We planted 21 trees in the Amazon.
That's awesome.
Great.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It is absolutely awesome. I will say that I think my favorite part of this tournament, and you made mention on one of the posts, was the strategy that had to come into play at some point. If you'll notice, and I'm not tooting my own horn on this, I had two decisions I had to make, and that got reflected in the Any 5 category.
Yep.
So if you look at the results, you'll see I think I got the biggest pickerel in the pickerel category. I think it was like 25.5, right? And then I finished second in the smallmouth category. I think it was to Mr. Jenkins. Am I correct in that? Or was it Mark Hood?
I think it was Jenkins. No, hard Mark. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't want to short them, but I finished second to Mark.
Okay, yeah.
And that's fine, because I had caught those fish. And then after I had caught those two fish, I caught two fish in those categories that were bigger. So they got shunted over to the Any 5, because I didn't want to lose a 25.5-inch pickerel and a whatever it was, a 26, I think, inch striper. Yeah. So the biggest striper and the biggest pickerel that were caught in the tourney weren't actually in their categories. And I don't know how often that happened with other fish, but I think it might have, right?
Yeah, there was a few times where that did happen, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, the anglers were faced with that choice of, hey, I've got a great fish.
Yeah.
Do I, in a category, in its own category, do I want to replace that fish with another one, or do I want to shunt that fish over to the Any 5? And that strategy was, I mean, that, for, honestly, where I was fishing for a couple of days, particularly those days I hit the pickerel, and the stripers, I had to really think about that. And you know, what ended up shaking out was in the other five, the Any 5 fish category. I think I ended up fielding four stripers, and then that 26-inch pickerel stuck around in there. So that was...
Yeah. And it was great. Like, I love puzzles, and I love seeing that play out, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It was completely different. I've never even thought about that in a tournament. And it was a wild card division. And, you know, and yeah. The one last thing I want to say about that was that division was where, you know, I was kind of quaking in my boots that last weekend, because I honestly know I'm not going to, you know, by saying this, I don't want this to come off as disparaging any other angler's abilities. I don't know personally a lot of the people that we fish with. I only know, you know, myself and Bobby and Nelson and Jeremy that were in the tournament. And Nelson went on vacation to go shark fishing every year. And I was literally quaking in my boots, asking for texts from him, like, hey, if you catch a shark, let me know.
Yeah.
And he put one up. And then the next day, I think he had two or three days of it. The next day, he didn't get any. And then the third day, I honestly think he sat on the beach with his surf caster and just grew a beard, didn't eat, maybe slept there.
Oh, my God.
And he ended up, yeah, and there was nothing coming from him. So I, at like whatever it was, 8:30 on Tuesday night, I sent him a text saying, hey, what's going on? Where's, you know, all week I'd been saying, where's the Sharknado, and sending him memes and gifts and all sorts of stuff. And he said, I've got tragedy. He goes, I had two that were ones that got away, and one of them was really big. And just, he told me the stories, and I'm going to leave those for him to tell. But, my immediate response was a gif of Steve Harvey saying, thank you, Jesus. And then I was like, oh, I'm sorry to hear that. but yeah, that was a really neat twist on a tournament. I can't say enough about it. I really loved that. That was a wild card, you know?
Yeah. So, you're going to have to do that again for the next one, but it will definitely be incorporating some of your input at the same time. So
yeah,
that'll be fun to play out.
Yeah. But we had our good conversation, and whatever, you know, whatever my 2 cents is worth, it's worth half a cent, whatever. It's all good.
Yeah.
I had a blast with this tournament, and it was something I'd recommend, because, you know, even if you're just a primary bass angler like myself or whatever, like I had more fun with those 20 plus inch pickerel, and it was just an absolute blast. And luckily I didn't lose any fingers, so that's a bonus.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think with that number of pickerel, you kind of got lucky.
When I thought about talking about this with you guys, I mean, really the luck came in with that catfish and the trout. The pickerel I had actually, I knew where they are. I feel confident that if I had to go get a pickerel like that, depending on the weather and the time of year, I'll take my chances.
Yep.
You know what I mean? But the catfish and the trout were just, yeah, that was luck. I'm not going to say I'm a good catfish or trout fisherman, especially since I didn't use bait for the whole tournament. It was all, everything I caught was on artificial.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I think that'll be kind of interesting because I'll tell you what, in the August one,
hi.
I'm going to focus on some catfishing. I'm going to make that happen.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, I mean, I'm not going to name the place, but where we went, where I caught that catfish, I don't know if I told you, I think maybe it was the second time we went back. That's all I saw was bullheads paired off. So if you want to, you know, we know there's bullheads there. We can go there, but I'm not saying where.
Oh, no, definitely not. I wouldn't. I would definitely keep that under wraps for sure. No, that is some good stuff. That and I was surprised nobody answered any carp. There are some monster carp, especially, I mean, you know, it's a nationwide tournament. Anybody can you know, fish what they want. But in our backyard, where we're all based in Western Massachusetts, there are some massive carp in the Connecticut River, and I'm surprised nobody had gone for them. But I say that somebody may just go and, you know, pick up a can of corn and some giant hooks and go for it, and we'll see what happens. It'll be interesting. I'm thinking.
Sturgeon,
I mean,
for a second there.
What's that?
I was like, go get that sturgeon. Those things are cool looking.
They
fish.
Are.
I was post one of those up.
I saw. Only problem is in mass, you can't take them out to photograph them. If you catch one accidentally, you got to release it right away. They're protected.
Oh, yeah. I do not recommend anyone doing that. I did not know that.
There are other states though. You could catch sturgeon all day. There are other states. Just in mass.
Gotcha.
I think Connecticut might actually be one of them where you can get away with it. I'm not. Don't quote me, but it's possible.
Right.
Might have to take a ride with the Hookset Hoodlum boys. Those are the guys I want to get in the August one. So Hookset Hoodlums, they got to get in on this. And I think they're
going to be slinging the bass, right?
They're definitely going to be slinging the bass, but they're multi-species guys as well, and they get around.
Awesome.
Yeah, they get around. It'll be pretty interesting. We'll see what happens. That's what it's all about. I'm going to try to get creative too with the way we do standings,
totally.
And I might actually make an alternating day. I'm thinking about using YouTube and doing a sort of a channel there in between episodes. So we'll see how it all plays out. But I think
Fantastic.
It's going to be a whole lot of fun. And I think it's pretty obvious, Seth, that both Sean and I are very excited about the next one.
Thank you so much. Thanks for being involved. And I had a blast just following along and doing watching everybody just make donkey noises on my phone. It was great.
That was one of the best parts. I think the app is a whole lot of fun, and it keeps you just updated enough. And it's good stuff. It is. It's really, really good stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sean, do you have any?
I would like to add.
Go for
I would
it.
Like to add real quick. You know, once I got away from that pickerel in the last week, you guys have no idea how hard I fished for pike.
Oh, like, I believe it.
Every day I went out for pike for a week. I tried four different lakes where I've caught pike, and it's a tough summer bite. And the one that I've had some success in, I don't know if the lake I was at had been hit with herbicides or algicides or anything like that, but I found like this huge die-off of grass shrimp in it. And I was like, oh, something's not right. Yeah, I could not hook a pike if somebody paid me. I could not hook a pike if I was in a chronic trip tournament, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
So
I was wondering if anyone would go to grab the pike too. Those are really cool looking fish.
There was one day where I was out there on the river with my buddy Tim Jacks, and that was part of the goal. I was like, yeah, I got a big whopper plopper to throw around, hook a big pike. Probably would have helped to have a steel leader in place so I don't lose that bait. But that was the goal, you know.
You got to live dangerously, man. You got to go bareback with pike, no leaders.
Oh, man. That's like a $25 plopper, though, the 190. Maybe I got to downsize.
Well, then you got to learn how to manage line. I don't know what to tell you.
Learn how to manage line. I love it. I love this guy. Oh, geez. Awesome, guys. Well, this is really good. I'm looking forward to August, and I'm going to put a promotional piece right at the beginning of all the shows leading up to the August launch and telling people to visit chronictrips.com and, you know, join for the August. As soon as we get word that everything's live to go and start signing up for it, then go for it. Yeah. Or just download Fish Donkey and then, you know, do a search and join in that way.
Yeah. Thank you so much, and I'll awesome. that hopefully that will be no later than Sunday night.
Oh, perfect.
Hopefully tomorrow. I'm trying to shoot for Friday.
I love it. Yeah. It sounds awesome, Seth.
Yeah, awesome.
Thanks again for hosting.
Thank you so much. Thanks so much for sponsoring and participating and all your input and making this better and having a lot of fun.
Well, we're going to wrap it up, and we will see you. We'll see you for the next Chronic Trips Elevated Virtual Fishing Tournament in August, all month long, the month of August. It's going to be great. Come and compete. It's a whole lot of fun. Win some fabulous prizes. It'll be good stuff.
Again, this was an out-of-the-box thinking tournament. Loved it to death. Can't wait for the next one. I mean, this was a blast.
Yeah, no, thank you so much. I can't wait to show you your earnings.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my surprise gift at 200 inches has got me sleeping better at night. I can tell you that.
Oh, well, you're going to be sleeping for a month, my friend.
Great. I hope one of the other prizes was a defib then.
I know, right?
Oh, awesome. Oh.
All right, Seth, take care. Sean, I'll talk to you soon.
Yeah, you too. I'll talk to you soon.
All right, take care, guys. Sean.
Hey everybody, Sean the Fisherman with my weekly story. I want to talk a little bit about this this one experience I had on a holiday weekend up on one of the small lakes I fish in the Berkshires. You guys have all heard me reference partying before, whether people are on jet skis or boats or even on the shore, and you know, they're out there to have a good time and not fish. Well, that affects the fishermen who are out there sober trying to fish. So on this one day, there's a longer road near this lake. And I heard a group of people loudly coming down, and it was about 5-6 o'clock in the morning, very early. My first thought was, well, they've been drinking all night. Can I prove that? No. What chances are they were? So they came down, grabbed a picnic table by the water's edge, continued talking loudly, and they got quiet for a while. When I looked over, I saw a plume of smoke rising from the picnic table. So I said, okay, good. They've got some quiet medicine. Kind of laughed to myself. Another minute went by. And one of them loudly started singing, set to the tune of the Oscar Mayer song, "My Vagina Has a First Name." It's M-A-R-T-Y. And that hung in the air. And there was silence. And one of his friends said, "Dude, why is your vagina named Marty?" At that point, waves were coming out of my boat because I was laughing so hard and trying not to disturb them. And I was stifling laughter. So you never know what you're going to hear or see when you're out on the water on holiday weekends when people are partying. I'm Sean the Fisherman. Have a great week.
Hey, guys. Bobby Roastbeef here for another Jigs and Bigs episode. I've got Adam Laxton with us. Adam is a guest. He's a Western Massachusetts angler. And we met 100% through the app Fishbrain. That's how we kind of connected. So, Adam, how you doing, buddy? What's going on?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
Doing okay. I'm doing all right on my end. Things are pretty crazy. I'm on vacation right now, so I'm kind of recording this with a makeshift studio setup. But it's definitely working. I'm glad that that's the case. So, Adam, let's go ahead and get into this and tell our Jigs and Bigs listeners a little bit about you, a little bit about how you had, you know, discovered fishing and how you sort of got it elevated to the point where, you know, you're an experienced angler like you are today.
All right. Well, as a kid, probably between 8 and 10 years old, I just had, you know, the basic spinning combo and random hand-me-down tackle box from friends and family friends. I had a family friend that would take me fishing around the Westfield area, which is where I grew up. Spent a lot of time at Congamon Ponds. And then as I got older, I got into skateboarding. And that kind of took over for 10, 12 years. And yep. Now I'm older, just relaxing, can't really afford to get hurt and jump down things on a skateboard anymore. Yep. So I kind of got into the YouTube scene, watching a lot of the Guggen Squad stuff, and it kind of led me back and lit the spark back up. And now I grabbed some equipment and just fell in love right away. And I've been at it month and a half, 2 months, been fishing almost every day and, yep. and just have a lot of fun doing it.
Nice.
Meeting new people and discovering new places to fish. And yeah, just that's the new hobby.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's amazing the kind of impact that fishing can have, you know, when you kind of pick it back up. Now, do you find now that you're like a little bit more focused than you were when you were, you know, pre-skateboarding or like back then? I assume you were probably like me, fishing for whatever would bite, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Back when I was a kid, it was kind of just like split shot weights, a little hook, some worms, and just cast it out, and whatever I caught, I caught.
Yep.
And now I've definitely leaned more towards the bass angling and target, you know, largemouth specifically, and just learning as much as I can and having a lot of fun doing it.
Absolutely, man. What's your favorite season for fishing?
I would have to say the springtime, you know.
Yep. There's,
I love the sight fishing and fishing the spawn and all that. So
yeah, spring, I think spawn fishing the spawn is, I think, is everybody's goal, like everybody's favorite. You know, it's just, but the weather is so good in the spring. It starts getting a little bit warmer. It's not too hot yet. It's pretty awesome.
Yep, the water starts up, and that's probably one of the best times to catch a big one.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. No argument there, for sure. Is there any kind of like a weather condition that'll make you decide like, hey, we're gonna call it a day? You know, that's or you're just done with it, or you will prevent you from going out at all?
Not too much, because I'm still trying to, you know, experiment and learn things, and you know, like with all the, it's been raining like crazy the last 4 or 5 days here, and that's kind of deterred me a little bit.
Yeah,
but I even went out, you know, because you can't be a good angler unless you can fish in every condition.
No, that's true. That's a good point.
Unless it's really, really pouring rain or just super hot and muggy, I'm going to head out there and get my lines in the water, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. What are your preferred types of bodies of water to fish? Are you more of like a small and medium pond guy? Do you like large lakes, or do you need current or rivers and streams more your go-to?
I'm really enjoying like the small to medium ponds and lakes right now, but yep. I'm thinking about maybe getting into fishing for smallmouth in the river. I'm right by the Connecticut River, so
nice.
I've heard there's some great smallmouth in there, so that might be something I'm looking to try soon.
Oh yeah. No, the river is in our area is just a huge resource. Like just
right.
a huge resource. And no, you know, I mean, even like I have my issues with river fishing, my challenges that I need to like fishing when you're dealing with current, it takes a much larger sort of focus on your part, you know, because the landscape can change so quickly. As far as like, let's talk baits. Like what's your biggest confidence bait?
Biggest confidence bait gotta be a chatterbait, and I'll throw. I do like a swim bait on the back of it a little bit, but my go-to is a creature bait on the back of it, and I just love the way the action is, and I think the fish do too, because that's how I catch most of them.
Yeah, no, chatterbaits are absolutely fantastic. Biggest smallmouth I ever caught came on a quarter ounce green pumpkin chatterbait with I think it was a Bandito bug trailer.
Yep, that's what I was using. I love the 3/8 black and blue trailer bait with a Okeechobee craw Bandito.
Yep. Very nice. Oh, yeah, that's a good one. They have some great colors, the Guggens. They really do. Like, their combinations are just freaking dynamite. They're really, really, really great. There's a green and blue color that they have that's so subtle, but it's I really, really enjoy it. So there's one question that I've been asking. It's kind of gotten pretty popular, and it started as a little bit of a joke, but I like to kind of keep it going. And there's a saying in the fishing industry that tackle companies that make different lures are more effective at catching suckers than they are at their products catching fish. What is, like, in your opinion, in your entire lifetime, what do you think is the most ridiculous fishing tackle trend? And also, have you been guilty of trying it?
Oh, man, that's a good question. I think those walking baits with, like, the wings on the side of them are a little ridiculous. And, like, the duckers and stuff like that.
Yep.
I haven't tried them, and I've heard mixed things. I've seen people on YouTube catch fish with them, and I've heard people say, oh, they suck, don't bother.
Man, that's great. You know what's funny? I think my father, like, way, way back, used to have one of those winged baits. It was a bat, and I was infatuated with the thing. I thought it was the coolest thing ever. And he was never big on using artificial lures at all. He was definitely a live bait guy, so I thought it was kind of interesting. He had some of the gear that he had. I remember this thing, like, crystal clear. And it's just, yeah. I don't know. Everybody's got their thing. Right now, we've been talking a lot about the spiders that Lunker Hunt puts out. And then I had somebody I think it was on Facebook, had shared a picture of the flying lure, which was like a TV thing back in the late 80s. Like, it was the big buzz one. It's supposed to, like, I think it was some kind of a tube with a fold in it. I don't really know what it was necessarily all about, but it was definitely kind of crazy.
That's before my time, but I'll have to look it up.
Well, I'm trying to actually acquire and get a bunch of these things so that way I can use them as prizes and, you know, have some fun with them.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's good stuff. Let's talk about now this is like the sort of the point of the whole interview. We'll get right to it. Let's talk about your two points in your fishing story. Tell me about tell me about your biggest the moment you're most proud of, whether it's a personal best or not, but like the moment you're most proud of when it comes to fishing. You could share a personal best as well if you like, and then also tell me like the biggest epic fail, like something where it ended badly, or, you know, so anything.
All right, well, definitely proudest moment is going to be the personal best. I was up at a college near me. It was spawn season. Yeah. There was a big one right holding right on the rocks, right off the bank. I kept seeing it, and so I just started flipping towards it, you know, threw everything I had at it.
Yeah.
Probably the second or third thing I threw at it was a black and blue 5-inch worm. Mm-hmm. I believe it was a male fish because it was definitely locked on a bed and it was still early. So he picked that up. Stupid me, being the young angler that I was, that I still am, didn't know he had it in his mouth. So missed him on that, got into a crazy panic and just, oh my God, I missed him. What am I going to do? I blew my shot. So just kept changing lures. Finally went weightless Bandito bug, that Okeechobee craw color.
Yep.
And threw it in there, probably third or fourth flip in there. It landed in the perfect spot, and he just munched it. And I yanked him, and that was the greatest moment, the greatest feeling. That was my first, you know, decent-sized fish. It was, according to my measurements, I used a length-to-weight table online. And
yep.
And at about 4 pounds, 4 ounces. So
it's a good fish.
Yeah, it was great. It felt great. And I was on top of the world. You know, one of the first things I did was call my best friend and send her a picture of it. And like, look at this, look at what I just caught, freaking out. And
yeah.
And it just, like I said, just top of the world feeling.
Oh yeah, 100%. That is a great, great feeling. And that's the thing about sight fishing, is it really, the name of the game is just agitating that fish. So, you know, changing out the lures as you need to, and just putting it right in front of them over and over and over again. That's how you get them to bite. You definitely, you know, you did the right thing there. You know, as far as experimenting and working and staying tenacious with going for the bite. That's huge.
Exactly, and. Exactly what you just said was a huge learning experience.
Yep.
I learned that that just keep on trying, flip different baits, and don't give up.
Yeah, yeah, it's absolutely true. Now, what about your biggest fail?
Oh, man, my biggest fail. Man, probably just the days of going out. There's been a couple of days where I've gone out there and just been so close, had them to the bank, and they've come off the hook or stuff like that. You know, I haven't had any major fails yet, thankfully. But I've had a lot of them jump off at the bank on me.
That is soul-crushing when it happens. That absolutely. Is absolutely soul crushing. I just saw it a little over a week ago, where a buddy of mine had a monster on a topwater frog, and she jumped out like mouth to tail completely out of the water, and then that hook just let go. Boom.
Yeah.
It was not the greatest hook set to begin with, but we were both like jaw on the ground, like, whoa, I can't believe that. Unbelievable. Yeah. It happens though. Awesome. So
it all starts with the hook set.
Tell me about your, like, what is a fishing talent that you have? Like a skill when it comes to angling that you feel is your strongest suit?
I would have to say definitely the power fishing, like the moving baits. Mm-hmm. I really enjoy that. You know, I don't have the patience to sit there and drag a jig or drag a worm. So yep. I'd rather throw on that fast moving cover water, and that's what I'm best at. That's how I catch most of my fish.
Yeah, absolutely. You got to do. Somebody said, I think it was Jordan. I think it was Jordan Capone. Said it on this show. He was like, you got to fish the way you like to fish. Nobody's going to, you know, you're never going to stick with it long enough to be able to catch anything if you're doing a technique that you don't enjoy using. So, you know, fish the way you want to fish, and then ultimately you'll find success one way or the other.
Yeah, absolutely. That's awesome, man.
All righty, Adam. Well, we're going to go ahead and wrap things up here. I got a bunch of little segments I got to put together. Thank you so much for doing this little interview here, man. Do you have anything that you want to promote, like your YouTube or Instagram or anything where people can check out some of your catches?
Yeah. If people want to follow me on Instagram, it is western.mass.bass. And I'm looking to buy a GoPro in the next couple of weeks and get a YouTube channel started. So if you follow me there, you can see any updates, any catches, new gear that I grab, any advice that I have to give. Just follow me there and I'll keep you posted.
Absolutely, man. That sounds great. Awesome. Well, and also, what about Fishbrain? We know you're on Fishbrain.
Yep. Fishbrain is my full name. Just search Adam Laxton and you'll find me.
Very nice, man. Well, hey, it was good talking to you, buddy. When I get back in town, we got to make some plans and we'll go out fishing.
Awesome. Thanks for having me, Bobby.
See, now I told you we were going to have ourselves one hell of a show, and we did, didn't we? It was a good show. It was a little all over the place, but that's what happens when you have national holidays and vacations and things like that to kind of tie together. It's just been an amazing week, guys. We're in it now. We're in the summer. It is just wild. Thank you very much for hanging with me. Been getting a lot of really good feedback. Also, the shipments for merchandise have gone out. I've been getting a lot of messages. People have been sending pictures over, and I will be putting up a post of folks that are wearing their t-shirts, their Jigs and Bigs gear. If you want to get your Jigs and Bigs gear, all you got to do is go over to jigsandbigs.com and click on the store tab. You can get your merch right there. Just click on the merch tab and it will bring you right over to the store. You can get whatever you need. We've got hats, we've got shirts, we've got long sleeves, we've got tanks, we got hoodies. We've got, you name it, all kinds of good stuff. Thanks, guys. It really means a lot to me. You guys are the best listeners ever. You're absolutely amazing. I appreciate you more than you realize. Remember, we've got a very, very, very active Instagram and Facebook page. Go ahead to jigsandbigs.com. You can get all of our social links right there. And also share jigsandbigs.com with your friends. If they're not necessarily podcast people, quote unquote, I'm holding up air quotes. If they're not podcast people, the best thing you can do is to send them over to jigsandbigs.com, because we've got every single way that they can get the show. Plus they can stream it right on the webpage if need be, right from the podcast page. It's that easy. Thanks so much, everybody. Have yourselves a great week, and I will see you guys in 7 days. Tight lines, everybody. Have yourselves a great week.